Amazing lighting makes for amazing art. It's time to take a deep dive into how shadows work and what makes them look realistic. By the end of this video, my goal is that you'll be excited and ready to create something beyond what you've ever done before, with lighting and shadows that leave your friends amazed and impressed. When I'm scrolling through artwork on Instagram, there's a common trend in the artwork that stands out the most, and that's good lighting and good shadows. And while shading can be an intimidating subject, it can also be fun. So my goal today is to teach you the essentials, then show you some quick strategies to apply them to your work without needing to study shading for weeks or months before creating something amazing. This is my second video of this series. In the last video, I showed a simple version of shading that I recommend watching first if you're just starting out. I'll include a link in the description below. We're going to start by going through the different types of shadows, and I'll show you some examples of these in photographs and illustrations so you can see how they look in different contexts, in both realistic and artistic examples. Then I'll show you how to start creating these shadows for yourself in your drawings and some practice activities that I recommend before you try applying these to your final coloring pages. And at the end of this video, I'll give you three specific strategies that you can use to create dramatic effects and increase the impact of your lighting and shadows in your artwork every time. So let's start with a brief lesson about shadows. And don't worry if you can't keep up, because I'll include all this in the blog post in the description below so that you can see it at a glance. There are two kinds of shadows: form shadows and cast shadows. A cast shadow is what you create when you literally cast a shadow. That's the shadow that appears when your object blocks the source of light from the background or from other objects. Cast shadows can be long, short, any shape, any size, any direction, with soft edges or hard edges, all depending on the light source or the light sources that are casting them. One of the best ways to learn to draw cast shadows is to use reference images and photographs to see how light acts in real life, so you can recreate realistic cast shadows in your drawings as well, but more about that later. Then we have form shadows. You can think of the word form as another word that describes our object's 3D shape. The form shadow is the shadow on the object itself, and this can be separated into a dark side and a light side based on where our light source is. By giving our objects a light and dark side using form shadows, we create depth and make them appear more 3D. But let's take it a step further. Both light and shade can be broken up into further categories that can help us to identify areas in our artwork that need more detail and can help bring our drawings to life. Our light can be broken up into highlights and light middle tones. The highlight is the brightest spot where our light source meets the object, and the middle tone is the general area that is receiving light from the light source. Now let's go back to the dark side.
Give yourself to the dark side.
Like we have a light middle tone, we have a dark middle tone. And a quick tip: the dark middle tone is always darker than the light middle tone, even if they look the same in a photo. This is a big key to making your lighting work. We have our core shadow, which is the darkest point on our object that receives the least amount of light. And then we have reflected light. This is where your object might be sitting on a white or colored surface, and it actually lightens some of the shadows because the light bounces back off the surroundings. And finally, occlusion shadows. I explained these briefly in my last video. Basically, occlusion shadows happen when two objects are so close together that it's impossible for the light to reach in between them. These areas will almost always have shadows no matter where the light source is. Enough talk, let's look at some examples. So this chess piece has a lot of contrast and it's very easy to spot the shadows. We have an occlusion shadow underneath. We have two different cast shadows here, which means there are actually two light sources, but our main light source is coming from the left, which is what is casting the most shadows on the form, on the object itself. We have a lot of highlights on the left and we have our core shadow on the right, which means that we can actually split a line right down the middle to separate our light side on the left and our dark side on the right. So that's a really great example to show just how much the light makes a difference between those light middle tones and those dark middle tones. Next example is a little bit more subtle, but we can see a cast shadow here, which helps us to work out where our light source is coming from because we can actually draw a line following the edge of the cast shadow. Now, right underneath the butterfly, we've also got a bit of an occlusion shadow, and because of the angle of the butterfly's wings, the light middle tone and the highlights in this case are not actually close to the light source, they are actually on the other wing because of the angle that it's facing. Our next example has a lot of occlusion shadows. As you can see, I'm drawing here in red. These are all the areas that the light just cannot reach no matter where the light source is. You can also see that the left side of our picture has a lot more light than the right side, meaning that our light is coming from the left side. And again, we have our light middle tones and our dark middle tones generally keeping to those sides. Now this next one isn't a photo, it's a piece of art and the lining is coming from the center. So while it's not entirely clear exactly where this light source is, you can see the creative effect by bringing the light from in the scene itself. Kind of like a vignette where the light is in the center and as it gets closer out towards the edges and closer to the camera, it gets darker and darker. And so if we're separating our light from dark, we can do that by drawing a circle in this case. The lighting from behind is creating a core shadow on the front of all the trees, which creates a silhouette effect, which is a very effective look. And finally, I wanted to look at these pictures because I actually found this same picture twice, but with two very different examples of lighting. Now the light is actually coming from the same direction, and we can tell that if we trace those lines, like I said earlier, where the cast shadows are coming from. So in both cases, the lighting is coming from the top right. The big difference here is the contrast in these images. The left one has very little contrast and the right one has a lot of contrast. But other than that, if you actually look at all of the individual cast shadows and all of the little details, they are very similar. All of the cast shadows fall in the same places. All of the core shadows fall in the same places. Even the fine little details are the same, with the difference being the higher contrast and the darker shadows on the right picture. Now, by this point, you might be ready to move onto the drawing, but I highly recommend looking at a few more images for yourself first, like those I've included in the link below to see if you can identify the different shadow types. This exercise can help you to become more familiar with how light works so you can apply it to your own drawing. So now I want to take what we've covered and actually apply it to some coloring pages. The first step in learning to draw shadows, in my opinion, is to learn to color in black and white. That's an oxymoron if I ever heard one. Realistic shadows are all about using the right values. Our color values tell us how dark or light a color is, and getting this right is the key to making our shadows look realistic. In fact, if you want to know if your color values are accurate when you are doing your final drawing, snap a photo on your phone, convert it to black and white or grayscale in any photo editing app, and then see if it still looks right without the colors. This is a great little trick to identify if your lighting and shadows are correct. So before we try to draw shadows with colors, I highly recommend practicing your skills in a single color first. Once you've mastered black and white, then we can convert this method to color, and I'll show you how to do that in a few moments. So I've printed off this coloring page from my website, and what I'm gonna do first is just start with what I think are the easiest, most obvious shadows. So I'm using a light source on my right, kind of towards the bottom left, and I'm starting with my form shadows. I have basically split my objects in what is the dark and the light side, and I am not going too heavy straight away, but I am doing my darkest shadows on the left, and I'm doing just some slight shading on the right as well, trying to keep the dark middle tones much darker than the light middle tones. So next I'm going in and adding some of the occlusion shadows. Now again, I'm not doing all the occlusion shadows straight away. I'm just doing the really obvious ones to start with. And that to me is the areas inside the pots where there's just not gonna be much light. While I'm doing this, I'm also gonna go back and just darken some of those other shadows on the back of the pots, which are our core shadow, which will be where there's just not going to be much light. Now, as you're doing this, remember, I'm just doing this to show you the dark and light values, but you do need to consider that your values will also depend on the color of your objects. So when you apply this to your picture, if you're going to be coloring a pot that is naturally a much darker color, then your highlight colors and your shadow colors are going to be very different to the colors I'm using here. We can assume in my picture that all my pots are basically a gray and that my dark tones and my light tones are based off that gray. But if your pot is white, then your dark tones are gonna be a lot lighter and your highlights are gonna be a very, very bright white. In the same way, if your pot is a black pot, your highlights are gonna be a lot darker and your dark tones are gonna be pretty much black. So those values can adjust up or down and get darker or lighter based on the color of what you are coloring. In the same way, we will be doing that when we actually do this on our colored picture. Now let's try and start working on our cast shadows. Now to do the cast shadows, we need to look at our light source and we need to draw some lines to work out where those cast shadows are going to fall. Now, how short or how long you want your cast shadows to be can vary. You can experiment, you can try different things, and like I've suggested in the past, you can look at different reference images to sort of work out what you want to do. I'm just gonna wing it and we're just gonna see what we can come up with. And I definitely recommend just having fun with this and experimenting and see what you come up with. Just start light and you can always add more, make them longer and darken them as you go. In this example, I'm just going to follow the lines and work them along the ground and also consider that if they run into other objects or other pots, that they need to go up those pots as well. Just like in real life, if a shadow is going to cast on an object, it will also fall onto that object and obscure some of that object. So cast shadows can be a little tricky, but I don't want you to be intimidated by them. Just try and think if the shadow was actually falling on that object. If that object was really 3D, where do you think that shadow would fall? It's okay if you get it wrong. This is all just a bit of practice. That's the fun of art, is that we just keep going and we just get better. And the more you practice, the more you will improve. Now I'm just looking back on the picture as a whole and adding some extra details. So at this point, I'm just working on and looking at individual parts and thinking of where else could use some shadows. So under the handles, on the plants themselves, because I haven't actually done that yet. And again, these are a little bit more complex shaped objects, so there's a bit of guesswork happening. But if we actually stop and just think about these as one object at a time, we can apply those same rules that we've learnt. We can apply the cast shadow method to each individual leaf or each individual petal. We can use the occlusion shadows between the petals and between the leaves. And we can actually apply those same methods, even the form shadows, and they will end up looking quite realistic even if we don't get them perfect. And as you can see, these fine details, despite me kind of winging it and just making it up as I've gone along, really make this picture pop in the end. It may not be photographically perfectly accurate, but it definitely brings the coloring page to life and it definitely grabs your attention when you first look at it. If you want an easy place to start, I always recommend finding a reference photo. Find a photo similar to your subject with lighting you can try to copy and see if you can copy the values, that's the light and dark areas, to create similar lighting. I'll include some links in the blog post of my favorite websites for the reference photos that I've shown you today. Now let's do this in color. Now before we begin, I've grabbed this coloring page again from my website, so I'll pop a link in the description. And for this one, I really wanted to use a reference photo because it is a little bit of a different shaped object and because I really wanted to create a bronze or a brassy kind of look. And that's something that I'm not overly familiar with. So again, a reference photo is a great way to do this. So the reference photo that I've used, I've actually got from Deposit Photos, which is a another website. It's not a free one, but I will pop a link in the blog post for that one as well, because there are some great pictures there if you can't find what you want on the free websites. So luckily, I found a compass picture that is almost the exact same angle as the compass that I'm drawing. Now, the goal with a reference photo is that if you can just find something that has the lighting you want to achieve and a similar angle, you can go from there. So while the compass doesn't have all the exact same details, it's got enough and it's got those same circular shapes that gives me a reference to use for my lighting. So as I'm coloring the outside, I can work on doing the lighter spots and the darker spots in the same areas as the reference photo. Now in this image, the lighting is actually in the top right, so I am going to go with that as well because I'm not overly familiar with how light interacts on shiny objects. I definitely like the idea of using the same lighting as their shiny object. And then what I'm going to do is then use that same reference, that same light source for the rest of my object, because I think that I can then apply the rules that we have talked about to then follow those rules for the rest of my picture without needing to find more reference images for all the other objects. As a side note, I definitely recommend having a full phone battery if you're going to use your phone for your reference image, because it got very annoying as I was filming this, having to constantly press my phone screen to turn my picture back on, as you will have noticed. Now I'm really going with a bit of a steampunk look for this picture. I did have some requests for a steampunk picture, and it's something that I personally love as well. So I've got my color catalog here. This is the color catalog volume 2, and I really wanted to find a color palette that would work really well with this picture to really work on that steampunk look, but also work in with the bronzy look that I've already got. So after filling with a few different pictures, I found this palette that has a bit of a teal. Now, if you know me, you'll know that I actually really, really love teal. So look, I probably would have picked this even without a color palette, let's be honest. But I think this for me was just an obvious choice. So we are definitely going with a teal background. So let's jump in, and we're going to start by creating those lines like we've talked about before to work out where our cast shadows are going to fall on the background. Now, as I'm coloring this, you'll notice I always like to start with the shadows first. I haven't talked much yet about how we're actually applying the same method to color that we've done with the black and white. So let me just talk you through that process quickly. In the same way that we applied our values and we started with our really dark colors for the shadows towards our really light colors for the highlights, I've actually picked two different teals for this background. So I've got a really dark teal and I've got a lighter teal. But on top of that, I've also got a black, which is a really, really dark, obviously, option as well. So now when I'm ready to actually do my shadows, I have grabbed the darker pencil first, and I'm just kind of blocking out where I think those shadows should go. This is not the final color that I expect these shadows to be. This whole picture is going to end up a lot darker. But what I like to do, in fact, you can see as I'm doing this, I'm not really getting them all very straight, so I probably will adjust these a bit as I go, but that's okay. I actually like to work in a bit more of a middle tone, but in the darkest areas, because then that gives me a bit more room to adjust and to tweak and to improve the contrast as I go. Whereas if you start straight into the darkest color, it's very hard to make those changes and then to undo anything you get wrong. So I actually like to work a little bit lighter and then to increase the contrast as I go. So I'm starting out by just putting those lines on every single possible area that I can see that's in the background that would have a cast shadow from our objects. And I'm drawing those lines and filling those areas with my darker pencil, but I'm not using my full pressure yet. I will come back to this area in a moment with a lighter pencil to fill it out, and then also with the darker black to really pad out those shadows, and you'll see it come to life as we go. We're just gonna pause on the background for a second because I really wanna finish the inside of the compass. Now, this inside of the compass is less about the lighting and shading. I actually just wanna work on a texture. So I'm going to grab some different colors and work on a bit of a sort of old vintage kind of look. There is some shading required. And if you remember back to the reference photo, we had quite a dark shadow on the right side, because the compass, you've got to remember, is actually a 3D object because the outer rim is quite deep and so the inside's quite sunken in. And so with that light source coming from the right, it actually creates a cast shadow on that right side from that right rim. That right rim is actually casting a shadow because the light can't get to that side because the right edge is in the way. So we've got that dark edge along the side there. What I've really done here to create this sort of dirty copper kind of look is really just taken a mix of colors. You can see them all here on my desk, of different yellows and browns and bronzy colors, and even some little greens and greeny yellow colors, mustards, those kind of colors. And I've really just kind of made this up as I've gone along. I've just done lots of light layering, mixed them up, done patches of the different colors, and then come back and kind of blended them together and used a lot of the yellows to kind of burnish over the top. As I have burnished over the top, I've tried to pick bigger sections where I would focus on the yellow, other bigger sections where I would focus on more of the browns. And so overall, it has this little bit of a gradient, while underneath you've got a mix of other different colors happening. I have added a small shadow along the inside of the actual, what do you call the thing in the middle of the compass? The arrow? Oh, what is it called? Someone tell me, please. Man, I feel really silly right now. The magnetic bit. I've added a shadow on that as well, because obviously that sticks out a little bit. And I'm just going back again. You can see I always tend to go back afterwards with more black just to really increase that contrast, because in this picture in particular, I really want to bump the contrast. But like I said, I usually don't go too heavy right away, because you can always add more, but you can't take it away. So now we're moving on to the rope. And what I've done with the rope is, again, I'm kind of just working out where the shadows fall first. Now I've started just with a main shadow that falls along the whole rope, and then I'm going back and working on the individual strands. So treating the whole thing as one object and then going back and looking at each little section as its own object, because the rope is a little bit chunky, so each section will actually create a very, very tiny shadow against the next part of the rope, and there are those occlusion shadows in between. Then I'm coming in heavier with the darker color to actually then really build up those shadows. Now that I know where they are and I'm happy with where the light source is, I'm really building them up. And then I'm gonna finish up by filling it in with the lighter colors, making sure I leave a spot for those highlights to really define that 3D form on the rope. I've actually then come back in and done some fine details just on the rope. So what I've just done is done some very fine line marks in two different shades, in a dark black and also in a lighter brown, just to create a bit of rope texture. That's purely optional. You can actually barely see it in the final picture. I just thought it might create a bit more of a realistic tone on the rope. One thing you'll notice as I'm coloring is I spent a lot of time just going back over the same things and just tweaking, just adding another little shadow here, darkening an area there. And I don't know if all artists do this. I don't know if this is something that I'm just doing as I'm developing my skills, if other artists get it right first time, but I actually think that this is just part of the process. I think if you're a perfectionist like me, the more you look at something, the more you go, oh, maybe I'll just tweak that. So I do that all the time. I'm always looking at more things that I can add, more things that I can improve, and constantly just adding little extra shadows, adding a little bit more contrast, and just working with it as I go. So I'm just gonna apply the same method. I won't talk you through the details on this other rope, with sort of the middle tones first, then the dark, and then the light, just again looking at where that lighting is and filling in any obvious shadows, and also looking at where the rope overlaps itself and putting a shadow on that second rope that falls underneath the first rope. Now I'm actually going back over the background. So I mentioned earlier that I like to look at the background and do the middle tone and then go back through the really, really dark spot. Now I've decided I'm gonna make this quite a dark background. So I've actually grabbed my black pencil and we are going dark. So I'm going back through all those cast shadows and actually fixing up some of the ones that were a little bit crooked. And I'm going in with quite a dark shadow in all those areas. Now, right now, this looks like a lot of contrast because I still have the white background. So you are looking at extreme white and extreme black. So it looks intense. But because my final picture is going to have a fairly dark background, at the end, this shadow is not actually gonna be that obvious. So wait until the end and you'll see what I mean. But for now, I really wanna just get these shadows in the right spot, and I am filling them out quite dark, but you can see the process as I go. So you'll get a feel for it as we keep going. If you're wondering as I go, how do you know where to put some of these shadows? It really is as simple as working through all of the steps that we talked about with those different types of shadows. And as I've found with some of these pictures, if you just start with the ones that jump out as obvious to you, the more of the picture that you complete, you'll find that others start to jump out at you as well. As you can see, I'm now adding shadows in areas that before I've actually already colored, like on the actual compass itself, where I didn't put a shadow before. Same on the roses. I hadn't done any shadows around them before, but now I'm looking at them realizing that's a really obvious spot to put a shadow because that rose is obviously sitting higher than the rose underneath it. So I'm actually going back and filling in shadows even in the background that I missed first time around, because the more you complete, the more it becomes obvious what the overall depth and the form and the shapes are. And so therefore it becomes easier to see what's missing. So don't feel like you have to get this all right away. Don't feel like you have to know exactly where every shadow goes, or you have to fill out all the occlusion shadows first, then all the core shadows next. Just start with what's easy. Start with what makes sense to you, and then just fill in what just feels obvious next. And over time, you'll start to have an eye for all the extra ones. You don't even have to get them all right. I mean, We talked basically before about reflected light, and yet in some of the examples that I gave you, they didn't have any reflected light. And in fact, in most of my drawings, that's not something I even bother with. Same with some of those other kind of shadows. I don't always include all these shadows in every drawing, but the more you include and the more you look at, the more realistic your pictures will begin to look. We are back to our background, and what I'm going to do as a part of this is sometimes when I've talked about shadows and I talk about gradients, we talk about the fact that the further away from your light source you get, the darker the entire space gets. So because we are looking for contrast here, I want to make sure my background has some contrast too. So I don't want to forget my background as a whole. So even though we are doing all these little cast shadows, I also want to create an overall background gradient here. So I'm quickly going to take my middle tone and complete a little bit of darker shading around the entire left-hand side and around the bottom edge to make it really obvious that our light source is coming from that right-hand side. Now, once we have done that, I am going to get my darker color and I'm going to start really filling out these shadows. We're starting to get close now to the actual colors of my background. This is starting to head towards how dark it's actually going to be, okay? So we're finally getting towards the end straight now in the background, I promise. This is the dark areas. This is where the core shadow is falling. So now I am ready and I am starting to really burnish and press a little bit harder with my pencil to really use this dark color and get these layers locked in. And we're almost done. So now I'm coming with my lighter color for the background and I am just filling in all of the rest. And as you can see, look, I'll admit I'm rushing this a little bit because I'm a little bit impatient. I am happy to admit I am getting better though, because these pieces do take a long time. I'm getting better, I promise. I'm not as impatient as I used to be. As you can see, the contrast is changing a lot. We no longer have our stark black shadows against our white background. Now the shading is quite subtle because now it is the dark teal versus the light teal. And so with our compass and our background done, I'm going to finish up with these extra details. And I'm going to work through this bit quite quickly because I do feel like we have covered a lot of this throughout this video and throughout my last video. So just to run you through what I'm doing with these extra details, we are now working on the flowers. I've got my dark tones, I have got my middle tones, and I have got my light tones. I'm using a white pencil to help really get the lightest colors out of the highlights. I am using some black, even though I don't always recommend black, because I really want the contrast in this. If you're wanting a more subtle look without the high contrast, you don't have to use black at all. You can just use a darker tone of the same color. And then I've got a darker red and a lighter red, and that's enough in this case to create the contrast in my picture. On every flower that I'm doing, as you can see, I've created a dark side and a light side. The light side is toward the light source, the dark side is away from the light source. And on each of those petals beyond that, I'm also trying to look at which areas of the flower and which areas of the petals are going to be shadowed by the other petals. Which areas are going to receive the light? Where are any cast shadows going to fall? Where are any occlusion shadows going to fall? And I'm simply repeating this process over and over again with each of the different flowers, the same with each of the petals, and I'll do the same when I get to these swirls in the background. Now for the swirls, I've decided to stick with the metallic look again. So instead of using a reference photo for these, I'm actually just using the compass I've already done as a bit of a reference. So I've grabbed the same colors, and because they are all kind of circular, I'm sort of following the same rules as the circle of my compass and looking at the points on that circle that the light hit and kind of just following the same pattern. And to finish up, I have grabbed my white Sakura Decoresse gel pen and I'm just adding some tiny little spots in areas that I really think will reflect the light. So some little spots on different parts of the metal that I think will really bounce that light back, and just some little spots around the roses where I think that the petals will just shine. Before I finish up with my three bonus tips that you can use to create dramatic effects, if you found this video helpful so far, please take a moment to subscribe, leave a comment below, and share this video with a friend. I've also got a ton of resources on my website, sarahreneclark.com, including your chance to win a set of Prismacolor colored pencils and other amazing prizes each month on my website. You can check it all out by pressing the I at the top of your screen now. Now let me share with you my three bonus tips to create even more impact in your lighting and shadows. Tip one is simple. Increase the contrast. Brighter highlights and darker shadows will always create a more dramatic effect. If you don't want to overdo it, you can always take a photo and use the contrast settings in your photo app to test it out first before applying the darker shadows to your final page. A white pen is a great way to really add some extra highlights, as I personally always love to do. Tip two, move the light source. Now I'm guilty of almost always drawing my light source from the top left because frankly, it's familiar, it's easy, and it doesn't take much thought. But changing the light source can dramatically change the mood and impact of your drawing. Just look at the difference the lighting makes in these two cupcakes with a change of direction and a slight change in the contrast. So I challenge you, and leave a comment if you think I should take up the challenge too, to mix up those light sources and try something unconventional. Start with some reference photos to learn how the light works and go from there. And tip three, use unique light sources. So instead of just using a distant sun or an ambient light, use a light within the scene, or different colored lights, or glowing objects. These instantly grab attention and create a level of interest, but they also require different techniques. So if that's a tutorial that you would be interested in, please let me know in the comments and I will show you. I can't wait to see what you create, and I hope you found this tutorial helpful. Please remember to check the website below for all the pictures I've used in this video and a written version of everything we've covered, along with links to all the coloring pages that I have used. I really appreciate you sticking around to watch this video until the end. I've got more videos here that I think you'll love, so subscribe above and then grab your pencils and get ready for this next video on the right.